I want to thank Scott for this invitation and this great introduction. I've never been to DePaul, but it's a real pleasure to be here, so thank you all very much. I am going to talk today about, hang on, let's put the PowerPoint up. What this title says, French Missionaries and the Roman Catholic Priesthood in the United States, 1789 to 1870. I know that I am in a room full of experts or amateur historians of the Vincentians, so I'm not going to try and be that to you or for you. I see my job here as trying to provide a somewhat larger context for the introduction of French priests to this new United States following the French Revolution. So the dates here refer to 1789 being an interesting coincidence. This is when the Diocese of Baltimore is founded, 1789, and the start of the French Revolution. Both of those events, so to speak, trigger the movement of French priests to this new American church. And 1870 is the end of the First Vatican Council, which is always just a nice way to put a book into something. But I'll get into that in a little bit. But the story did continue after that. Okay. L'Église de France est le maire de l'Église l'Amérique. This is a sentence taken from a book written by a Frenchman, Celestin Moreau, in 1856, called Les prêtres français émigrés aux États-Unis. All right? So basically, some French dudes who immigrated to the United States and they happen to be French. He says that the Church of France is the mother of the Church of America. And he goes to great lengths to describe how and why so many French priests came to the United States and their influence on that new, very fragile in many ways, American Catholic Church that was centered in Baltimore. Another important feature of this, and I'll get into a little more detail of it, so that picture there is of Bishop John Carroll, the first Bishop of Baltimore. He was really crucial in recruiting priests from France to the United States. There were several thousand exiled priests during the more tumultuous stages of the French Revolution. Out of those thousands, many of whom would go to Italy and other sort of safe havens, only about 20 came to the United States. So in the bigger context, not that many. But if you put it in the context of the United States, it's huge because it practically doubles the population of the clergy in the United States. So almost over a decade, the number of priests in the United States doubles. And it's because of this French imprint. John Carroll is critical in getting them over here, but so too are the Sulpicians and the Sulpician leadership in France. Sulpicians, the Society of Saint Sulpice, is, if you don't know, it's a body of priests who are, I guess they're committed to the education and formation of diocesan or secular priests. That's what they do. They train men to be priests in dioceses. They had about a dozen or so seminaries in France. It was a great sort of recruiting ground for Carroll to basically poach young men, mostly young men, to the United States. These men came over wearing kind of two hats. And so I point you to Gallicanism and Ultramontanism. Gallicanism, I'm not going to get into the details. It's basically the idea that the French church is autonomous or carries some autonomy from Rome, from the Vatican. Ultramontanism is the reverse, right? It's that you look over the mountains to the Pope, and the Pope is the chief authority within the church. The Sulpicians, I think, fall in a kind of middle space. They do come out of this Gallican tradition. They are French to the core. But given the circumstances of the French Revolution, it's not surprising that if you're looking for a source of authority in a time of trouble, where the church is persecuted, Rome is going to be important to you. So this the first half of the 19th century, as we'll look at a little bit later, does lead to what some describe as a Romanization of the Catholic Church worldwide, but also in France and the new United States. So I just want to point out those that these new guys that are coming in, they're kind of wearing both hats. And they're not terribly troubled by it. It's not like they don't sleep at night because they just, who am I allegiant to? They're just coming from a particular perspective. So the story, I think, of this early, at least when we're talking about the clergy and the institutional formation of the church in the United States, it's a story about a missionary church. It's a story about a national church, a nascent national church. It's a story about a Roman church and how the French priests and all priests in the United States are looking to Rome for guidance, for authority. And it's an immigrant church, because we'll see by the 1830s, 1840s, 1850s, the growth in primarily Irish and German Catholic immigrants is going to transform the laity and therefore the structure of the church in the United States. And the French are kind of at the beginning of all of these kind of moving parts in the United States. A missionary church, a national church, a Roman church, and an immigrant church. And they're going to sort of begin in that early stage and kind of experience and oversee that transformation. Yeah. All right. So just real quickly to give you, I'm going to go through basically 5 or 6 points. My goal here is, in addition to describing sort of the institutional growth of the Catholic Church through the movement of priests, I also, which has been done, there's oodles and oodles of books on, you know, when you have an institutional history of the church, it's a history of priests. What I tried to do in my book and what I'd like to do today is to, it sounds silly in a room like this with people who know, you know, priests and who are priests and are comfortable in it, that priests are human beings too. Yep. Everybody's minds are being blown right now. I know. But as historians, we've done a pretty shoddy job of looking at the personal lives of priests, to think of them as men who have a particular experience of Catholicism. It's a very particular way of being Catholic. And taking that seriously as an historian, I don't think really has been done. And some historians use the category of lived religion. Lived religion being this way of looking at sort of popular religion, so religion on the ground, the everyday. We as historians have done a great job of looking at lay people, lay Catholics, through this lens of lived religion. And priests oftentimes are foils to that lived religion, that they somehow don't have their own lived religion. They're just robots of the church. This is all not new to any of us in this room, but I'd like to kind of explore kind of the everyday experiences of these priests alongside how their decisions are also shaping this new American Catholic Church. So I want to start first with missionary formation in French Catholicism. By that I mean when these priests come to the United States in the 1790s and then the first decade of the 1800s, this first generation of immigrant priests, they are setting up seminaries. The main one's going to be in Emmitsburg, St. Mary's Seminary. And then there's going to be another Sulpician seminary or pseudo-Sulpician seminary outside of Bardstown, Kentucky. And I'll get into why Bardstown comes up in this story, a place that you probably never heard of. French priests, because they are now going to become the leaders of the Catholic Church in the United States, are very suspicious of American Catholics, at least to the extent that their willingness to bring them into the priesthood. They're just kind of suspicious of their upbringing in the Catholic Church. They're more inclined to go back to France to recruit kids, dudes, who they're familiar with, who are being trained in a more formal Sulpician or other religious order seminary. So they go, and I keep saying they. I'm going to give you a couple of key names here. Benoit Flagey, or Benedict Flagey, is going to be the first bishop of the Diocese of Bardstown, which is in Kentucky. William Lewis DeBerg is going to be the first bishop of the Diocese of Louisiana and the Floridas, later the Diocese of New Orleans. Ambrose Marischal is going to be, who's going to follow John Carroll as the bishop of, or the Archbishop of Baltimore. And that could go on and on. The French clergy become the leaders of the Catholic hierarchy in the United States. So they're making a lot of decisions about where new priests are going to be coming from. And so they're going to be pulling from and recruiting from, and they're going on recruiting trips, and they love doing that because they can leave the they can leave Bardstown and go back to Paris. And they're cool with that. They're cool with that. As far as education goes, so when they do try to train priests, either French guys that they're bringing in, and then they'll kind of start from scratch in these new American seminaries, or Americans, Anglo-Americans usually, they're going to be focused on, in the Sulpician tradition, this notion of l'esprit ecclésiastique, right? The ecclesiastical spirit. And that meant something particular for Sulpicians. It was very Christocentric, and which is not surprising because, you know, you want to be like Christ. But if you read their personal writings, their personal letters to each other, their personal reflections, their memoirs, their diaries, as well as their sort of textbooks, their published works by the founders of the Sulpicians, being like Christ is a really serious business. You are going to be like Christ if you're going to be a priest. And if you're failing in that, then you are failing as a priest. As you can imagine, trying to translate that to young men is a challenge. Add to that their hyper-awareness of the fact that they are unable to translate that Sulpician, the quality of education, the quality of priestly formation in a place like Emmitsburg, which is really a backwoods, and even furthermore, a place like Bardstown, Kentucky. So there's back and forth and great suspicion of Sulpician leaders in France over the extent to which they're willing to invest in the Sulpician presence in the United States. The expansion of the priesthood, or I should say the Catholic Church in the United States, grows in 1808 when you have the establishment of the Diocese of, so you have just one big, the Diocese of Baltimore is basically all of the new United States, okay? And they have jurisdiction over that. They get, in theory, Carroll gets to decide where priests go and who gets to do what, right? In theory. And we'll talk about how in practice things don't always work that way. But in 1808, the Diocese of Baltimore is elevated to an archdiocese. And we have four new dioceses. Boston, and the three of them are pretty obvious. Boston, Philadelphia, New York. Got it. The fourth one is Bardstown, Kentucky. And this is because of a pretty strong Anglo migration from Maryland, which was a strongly Catholic area of the eastern United States, and their movement into the American interior, the trans-Appalachian sort of migration. And so they're following Catholics. This is pre-immigrant church. So it's still primarily Anglo-Catholic church with some spattering of other ethnic groups. The key exception, of course, is going to be Louisiana, which has a French and then Spanish Catholic history. Missouri is going to also be kind of connected to Louisiana. The entirety of the Mississippi Valley is going to kind of fall under the authority of the new Bishop DeBerg in Louisiana. I'll give you one quote here from Ambrose Marischal, Sulpician guy who was the Archbishop of Baltimore. He worried about the seminarians in Kentucky. He said, "As seminarians in the woods of Bardstown are very exposed to lose not only his spirit of his mind, but also his ecclesiastical state. He said that the House of Education in Kentucky is something resembling much more a school of ignorant brothers than a seminary of Saint-Sulpice." Just to give you an idea of, like, they took this stuff seriously, and not surprisingly, right? They're training men to be priests. And if you can't get it, and you're not, the question is whether or not they can be formed as good priests in this very frontier setting. And if it's, and is it worth it? If you can't give them the good stuff, maybe we just need to train them all in France. This is it's a contentious debate going on. Now I'm going to look at missionary experience and frontier Catholicism. So this is where I want to think about priests as confrère and père, as brothers and as fathers. So this is a kind of not a theoretical category. It's thinking about priests as fathers. We're good at doing that, right? That's their job, is to be sort of the front of the house, right? They have to toe the line. They are representatives of the church. They are acting in the person of Christ. Got it. We know how that works. But what's great is that the letters and the writings, the private writings, shared among these brothers, these confrères, is stunningly open and candid and hilarious at times, really, really sad at times, disturbing at times. And it's because these guys are trying to make their way into this United States and also form effectively a new church or a presence of the Catholic Church in the United States. They've never been there. And it's, not surprisingly, not that easy. So I want to think about them as les confrères et les pères, and to think about examples of their personal suffering, living on the frontier. They write exhaustively of how they're traveling constantly. They're like circuit riders, like Methodist circuit riders. They're traveling hundreds of miles within a month. They're living in in bad weather. They're getting sick all the time. They're running into inhospitable Catholics, much less Protestants. They are vulnerable to anybody else, to the world of frontier America. So I'll give you an example. Michel Portier, who's going to be the future Bishop of Mobile, he is writing from New Orleans in 1818, and he's writing back to his confessor, his mentor, back in France. He writes, "It would be more consoling to go throw oneself among the savage and ignorant nations, to go freeze in the Canadian and Illinois woods, than to work in New Orleans, which he called the cesspool of the universe." He described New Orleans, furthermore, as sunk in a sewer of all the passions and of all the vices. He said that the common people of New Orleans have faces marked by crime and libertinage. I think that's how you pronounce that. They use that word a lot. And the presence of a priest is more terrible for them than hell itself. So this is basically a kid. He's a kid. He comes to New Orleans as a deacon. And he is overwhelmed. He goes on and on, letter after letter, back to his mentor. And he is writing down, "I am crying while I am writing this to you." The guy is distraught. It works out for him. He becomes a bishop. It's all good. But his experience is very similar to so many other of that second generation of priests. That first generation, the Flagets, the Marechals, the Dubourgs, they got it tough. And Flaget is the most dramatic of them all. That guy, he's constantly, writing back on how awful it is. But that second generation and third generation of priests who are recruited from France after the French Revolution, as things are kind of restored during the antebellum period of the United States of American history, they're constantly referring to their experiences in these ways. Another way to think about the priesthood in this frontier setting is to think about ecclesiastical authority. So not only is it difficult to control the rabble-rousing laity, but there's also some rabble-rousing priests out there too. Priests don't always get along in frontier America. There are great conflicts, great debates, fights over small things and big things, right? Where are we going to build this church? What are we having for dinner? And looking at these kinds of concerns that priests have, I think is important. Now, to the point of, and I'll give you just one example of the ecclesiastical authority. And this goes to William de Burgh, the first official bishop of Louisiana. He is appointed in 1815. It took, in the 18 teens, it took almost well, the entirety of Bishop Carroll's tenure to appoint his hand-selected bishop to Louisiana, which was historically and was predominantly a Catholic place. And not only that, a French Catholic place. What's interesting, though, is that the French Catholicism, as it had developed in France, was very different from the French Catholicism that had developed in Louisiana. And one particularly pesky priest named Antonio de Sedea really made life hell for de Burgh. De Burgh, the only way that the guy wasn't run out of town is because the Ursuline nuns put him up and sort of created this kind of spiritual force field around him so that the laity as well as the clergy wouldn't run him out of town. Ultimately, he did run out of town. He at one point he writes, "I longed for death, the welcome end of my martyrdom." And he has all kinds of great quotes because he just hated it. And he ended up kind of ultimately just going back up to Missouri. And he was pivotal in recruiting Rosati and De Andres to the United States. And I say scandalous priests too. I mean, these guys, you know, same problems that you and I have. You know, alcoholism, sexual misconduct, just running out on the job, disappearing for a month or two. These guys, they're doing all these kinds of things and dealing with that and trying to understand why they're doing that. And they're not just necessarily bad dudes. They're cracking in many cases. And it is kind of sad to encounter them in the archives and that kind of those kinds of experiences. As bad as it was, the experience or as the experience could be, the early 19th century is also described by historians as a period of missionary revival throughout the world as it relates to the Catholic Church. There's a kind of resurgence in interest in missionary work worldwide, the United States just being one pocket of that world. And honestly, as far as most priests in or aspiring missionaries in France, most of them do not want to go to the United States. It's not as sexy as a place like Asia or Africa. Okay, some of them, obviously, do come to the United States. And they do come for a variety of reasons. One is the establishment of the Ouvre de la Propagation de la Foi, or the Society for the Propagation of the Faith, founded in 1822 by a laywoman, but supported by the French Catholic Church. This was an organization that raised money to support missionary work around the world. You could go all day on the importance of this institution on this missionary revival. One thing they did, so it helped recruitment, it helped raise money for these missionary churches in the United States until the early 20th century was at least officially identified as a missionary church, as a foreign mission by Rome. So it's seen as a missionary church. They published the Annales de la Propagation de la Foi, which is basically the annals are mimicking the Jesuit relations or mimicking the earlier lettres édifiantes that were widely read, devoured by lay and clerical populations in France because they're just good adventure stories in a lot of ways. So the priests who are in the United States, many of them are French, and if you aren't French, you've been trained by French priests in the Sulpician mode, usually. They're writing these letters for the Society of the Propagation of Faith, and they're publishing these things. And seminarians are eating them up. They want to be a part of this missionary work. In the United States, they see it as a foreign mission, right? They're writing about it in those terms. They are consuming it. They are imagining it in those terms. What ends up happening, though, is that when they get to the United States, these young men, they are met not with... One thing that they loved were stories about Native American missions. There wasn't a strong Indian evangelization initiative in the Catholic Church in the 19th century. Very much unlike previous, when we think about the Franciscans in New Spain or the Jesuits in New France, that was their almost primary mission. It was secondary, if not tertiary, in the new United States. But they're writing all about it because it gets people excited. And when they get to the United States, they're not doing that. They're going to be the pastor of some backwoods parish, or they might not even have a parish. They're just going to have a circuit, and they're going to be riding around, and they hate it, right? So this kind of management of expectations and the how that, what they imagine they're going to do almost always fails them when they get to the United States. And so there's a period of kind of taking a deep breath, and if they don't go back, they got to just kind of press the reset button and get back on track. Joseph Rosati, who some of you know pretty well, he published a letter in the Annales responding to the inquiry, quote, of a young man who wants to consecrate himself to the Mission des Sauvages. So he's getting letters. They're getting letters from these guys saying, I want to get after it. And Rosati's closer to Indian territory, more so than other priests, more so than other dioceses. Rosati responds in no uncertain terms that, quote, his plan is very beautiful, but I believe it is impossible to achieve here in Missouri. He goes on to insist that the Indian nations inhabiting the territory of the United States will never be sheltered from occasions which expose them to interaction with whites. Goes on and on. The idea here is that, yeah, it would be cool, be great if we continued Indian missions, but we don't have the resources for it, we don't have the manpower for it, and the circumstances that we find ourselves in the United States right now, this is a period of Indian removal, a lot of unfortunate things are happening with the federal government and local governments and Native peoples, and they're just, by and large, not playing a very strong role in that. So we have colliding here this vision of a foreign mission, but in the reality, these guys, many of whom are French in the United States, their business is building a new national church, building that diocesan parish infrastructure that would mirror or model what's happening, what has happened in Europe. Just two more slides. One more wheel in this, you know, vehicle is Rome. And the politics, the missionary politics that go into this sort of American, French, Roman sort of triangle here. I haven't talked about the Vatican. I haven't talked about the Pope. I haven't talked about Rome. The Sacra Congregatio de Propaganda Fide, the Sacred Congregation for the Propagation of Faith, usually just described as the Propaganda Fide, was the sort of institutional arm of the Vatican overseeing all foreign missions. The United States fell under that that canopy as far as the Catholic Church was concerned. This coincides with what I described and what historians have described as the Romanization of the Catholic Church in the antebellum period of the United States. I shouldn't say, I'm talking about world history here. I can't say antebellum, that doesn't make any sense. Okay, early 19th century. On the one hand, French priests in the United States are very willing to look to Rome for authority. This is very different from John Carroll. John Carroll, if you know, when he was elected bishop, a key word here, elected, that was very unique. He got a special, or the small group of priests in the United States at the time got a special pass, basically, from the Pope. He said, okay, you can elect your bishop, but just this once. Forever after, I get to decide. And when Carroll died in 1815, the French hierarchy of the Catholic Church in the United States don't really care about that model that Carroll was trying to promote. They're very comfortable going back to Rome and making that be the source of authority for making those kinds of decisions. Carroll said at one point, I consider powers from the Propaganda Fide not only as improper but dangerous here in the United States. And he was after something. He was onto something here, right? He was responsible, and he was a product of the American Revolution. Okay, his family was involved in the American Revolution. He supported the American Revolution. The historian Jay Dolan at Notre Dame makes a clear distinction, maybe a little too clear, but he makes an important clear distinction between the Republican Catholicism, as he calls it, which is more of a democratically oriented way of doing business in the Catholic Church, versus, and Dolan even uses the word monarchical, Tridentine tradition of Catholicism. The French fall squarely under that Tridentine monarchical model. They would proudly wear that badge. And they looked to Rome not just for who's going to be the next bishop, but also things related to local circumstances, the peculiarities of American life that have to do with mixed marriages. There's no rule book. Yeah, technically, yeah, Catholics shouldn't marry Protestants, but hey, boss, they're doing it. What do we do? So very little mundane things, and they'll wait months to get those answers back from Rome. Slavery, and I'll end on slavery with the next slide, becomes something that they repeatedly go back to Rome on. So should we, can we sell our slaves? Should we advise slave owners to treat their slaves this way or that way? In addition to dealing with the laity, they also are looking to Rome to resolve conflicts between priests. And there are all kinds of dust-ups in the American Catholic Church between French priests and others. One of the big concerns for the French, you won't be surprised, is the rise of the Irish clergy. And so there's a lot of anxiety as the Irish clergy starts to, the hibernization of the Catholic Church, some describe it. They are concerned about losing that kind of hold over the hierarchy of the Catholic Church. So there are all kinds of local circumstances. I think it's important, and I'm not going to go into any more of them, to address how priests translate prescriptions from Rome, their French traditions, everything that they know they're supposed to do as priests in the local context of Kentucky or Baltimore or New Orleans, all of which they found to be difficult missionary proving grounds. The Vatican Council, another just last way to look at how Rome is important, but also contested idea when it comes to French priests, and this is over the question of papal infallibility, which was the big payoff in the Vatican Council of 1869 and 1870. Bishop Augustin Varro, who was the Bishop of St. Augustine in Savannah, he opposed papal infallibility, as did several French priests, falling under the kind of, at this point, they're kind of wearing the Gallican hat. And there are the leading advocates against papal infallibility are really coming out of France. He spoke this at the council. We foresee interminable strife would arise from it if papal infallibility became the rule, which we fear would impede the work of the ministry and perhaps destroy altogether the fruits of this Vatican Council among non-Catholics. This is very important in an American context, less so in a French context, right? You live in a Protestant nation if you are a Catholic priest in early United States. There is great anxiety over what would happen. It's already hard enough being this this outside religious group with this despotic pope, sort of with this global domination, all the conspiracies, all the paranoia that comes with anti-Catholicism in America. They're aware of that. And that is one of the reasons why some of them are arguing against it. Ultimately, only one American bishop votes against the papal infallibility. It's the Bishop of Little Rock, of all places. He's trained by French priests, but he's an American. I'll end with, I want to kind of just, I've given you kind of a big picture, priest formation, experience, missionary revival, and then their relationship with Rome. Slavery in the United States. If you're not talking about slavery in the 19th century, then you're not really talking about American history. It looms large in the South as well as everywhere else. Oftentimes, in the past, historians have looked at Catholic involvement in slavery and used what I call the cultural captivity thesis, right? There are these outsiders, they find themselves in a slave society, and they just kind of give themselves over to it. They're not gonna rock the boat. It's the way it is. We're just gonna go along to get along. And to some extent, that can get us a little ways towards understanding Catholic involvement in slavery, but only a little ways. Most of the dioceses in the United States during the antebellum period are in slave states. Catholic priests and Catholic lay people, certainly prior to the great immigration of Irish and Germans in the 1830s, 40s, and 50s, are living in slave societies. Many of them are slave holders. The church in Louisiana, broadly conceived, Mississippi Valley, Gulf Coast, is the single largest, if you think of it as, you know, one thing, it's the single largest slave-holding organization in the entire region. Still today, the Ursuline Convent in the French Quarter of New Orleans, the slave quarters is now the garage where they park their cars. It's still kind of in the fabric, the material landscape of Catholicism in Louisiana and elsewhere. There were pro-slavery priests. The Bishop of Natchitoches, Louisiana, a guy named Augustin Martin, in 1861, writes a pastoral letter. This is because he's a Confederate sympathizer. He says that slavery is, quote, the manifest will of God. And he looks to, among other things, the curse of Ham, another commonly used things that other Southerners and pro-slavery people are using. This goes back to, though, a question in 1839 when Pope Gregory the 16th issued an apostolic letter called In Supremo Apostolatus, which was basically an apostolic letter saying that slavery is wrong and we need to stop as a global institution. In my opinion, people around the world, they kind of read it. It could be read as a blanket, slavery is bad, you need to stop. In the United States, that was not the case. It was interpreted as the international slave trade should be stopped, and it already was illegal in the United States. Domestic slavery, however, that's not what the Pope is talking about. So domestic slavery as it existed could continue. This was reinforced by people like Antoine Blanc, who was the Archbishop of New Orleans. In an 1852 pastoral letter, he basically differentiates, and this is common in Protestantism as well, differentiates between soul liberty and legal liberty, and what's most important, the hereafter, right? As long as your soul is free to accept Christianity, then you're good. On top of that rather flimsy theological argument, there is the social order argument. And this is more of the pragmatic side of the argument. And it's like, and he says, basically, if slavery ends, then the social fabric of life in the South, and arguably in the United States, will crumble. We, the Catholic Church, have found a way to make a place for ourselves here. If that starts to crumble, then it might disrupt the gains that we've already made as an institution. On top of the fact that many abolitionists in the United States are also anti-Catholic, so there's that dynamic going on. So it's not a simple, slavery is bad, we should stop. And they're also making money off of it. And the recent stuff about Georgetown and their slaves, who they sold to a Louisiana planter, that in the antebellum period, that's all over the United States. It's just the most high profile example of this. It happens throughout the antebellum period. I have a picture here, though, to give you just a return to an end with the ambiguity, I think, of being a French priest in the United States is all about. This guy, I wrote my master's thesis on him. It's what led to this book. It ended up being like 2 pages in the book, but this guy changed my life. Ignace François Turgy is his name. He was born and raised in France. He was a chaplain in the Crimean War. He read a book called Le Casse de l'Oncle Tom. Uncle Tom's Cabin. And it changed his life. And he, like many young men, or he was actually a little bit older. He'd been around a little bit. Started sending letters to bishops back in the United States, one of them being Jean-Marie Audin, the Archbishop of New Orleans, previously the Bishop of Galveston. And he says, hey man, I want to be a missionary to the slaves. That's what I'm called to do. I want to do this. So he, and Odin's like, cool, I got you. You know, you just want to get a warm body and then you can tell him what to do. When he arrives, right at the beginning stages of the Civil War, Odin looks at him and says, you've been a chaplain, huh? Cool. You're going to be a Confederate chaplain. And he is one of about a dozen Catholic priests who become chaplains to the Confederates. And in New Orleans, you have this Creole population. And when you say Creole in the context of the Civil War and involvement in the Confederacy, you're looking at people who identify themselves with French or Spanish heritage, not necessarily people of color. And he becomes chaplain to kind of the elites of New Orleans. And he spends 4 years marching with his men. And when he returns, he's pretty sickly. And there's an abandoned church that the bishop says, cool, this is going to be the veterans' chapel. So the Confederate veterans have Turgy as their chaplain while he's kind of slowly dying from various diseases. And when he dies, he is heralded as one of the earliest examples of this lost cause motif that runs through post-Civil War South. Turgy, in the few letters that we have, never describes himself as a Confederate, never describes himself as a Confederate sympathizer. He does his duty as a chaplain, right? And he does have a kind of kinship with his men that he's serving. But he came as someone who was interested in being a missionary to slaves. He ended as an exemplar of the lost cause in death. And it's that kind of granularity to get down on the ground and get into the life of a person that I tried to do in the book, and I hope I've done a little bit of today, and see that being French, being a priest, wasn't just about being French and being a priest. There are a lot of moving parts, both big, sort of big scale, as well as just sort of on the ground everyday life. And I think that Turgy kind of exemplifies several hundred individuals who had to make their way in this new American church. Thanks. And this is my favorite picture of priests. It's really hard to find group pictures of priests in the 19th century. It's one of the only ones I could find. This is Jean-Baptiste Lamy in the middle. He was the Bishop of Santa Fe. And apparently he was like a prolific gardener in Santa Fe. And that's him and his boys. And then a little kid in the background. Yes, sir.
About halfway through your talk, you mentioned archives, and I'm curious, what is your source base for this analysis? Source bases.
Yes, yeah. So we were joking, Scott and I, before that Notre Dame gobbled up all kinds of archives throughout the United States and the world. So Notre Dame is a great one-stop shop for a book like mine. But specifically, the Society for the Propagation of the Faith has thousands of letters back and forth. And what's interesting is to take what was published, highly edited, highly polished, and what was taken out sometimes, but also what just didn't make it in. That's one big source.
Those archives are in France?
They are in France, but
copied here.
They got microfiche at Notre Dame. The Propaganda Fide, an even larger collection. It is silly large. And those two are at Notre Dame in microfilm form. In addition to that, diocesan archives, the big ones in my case were Kentucky, and now it's in Louisville. The diocese moved to Louisville in the 1840s, and New Orleans and Baltimore. Those are kind of the three hubs that I use. Now, almost all those papers are at Notre Dame, but sometimes it's just nice to go to Baltimore. But the Sulpician archives are also in Baltimore. So that forms the base, and really the book is made primarily of the personal correspondences between priests. And I initially wanted to name the book Les Confrères et les Pères, and then the subtitle. But the when I got the email saying, great, let's go, green light, let's publish it, and then the next paragraph was, but it's not going to be in French, the title, because nobody's going to look at that. So it lost it. But that's the bulk of the sources. Sir?
You mentioned Seynaeve, St. Augustine, so this probably predates the time you're looking at. There's this, how does when the French show up, you know, obviously it's the Spanish receding, how does that interplay? And is there much that left by your time period, or is it pretty much all history?
No, it's live because of the annexation of parts of Mexico during the 1840s. It's a Spanish Catholic tradition. Like Louisiana, it's mostly French Catholic tradition, with a little bit of Spanish thrown in there. Those churches had developed very differently. They have different diocesan authorities or bases. When the United States, when the jurisdiction moves to Baltimore, and Carroll or his predecessors say, all right, I'm picking my clergy, and he sends them down there. There's great conflict. Great conflict between the clergies, but also in the French Catholic opinion of the laity and their popular devotion, especially in a place like Santa Fe, where you have folk or popular forms of Catholicism that don't align with their more rigorous devotional form of and Roman-oriented form of Catholicism. So there's great collision and conflict and prejudice against non-European Catholics. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
I found your presentation most interesting, so thank you very much for the way you put it together. My question relates to the Sulpicians and your reference to seminary being Mount St. Mary's at Emmitsburg, which was a Sulpician, but no reference to Francois Magot and St. Mary's Seminary in Baltimore, which was the first seminary in the United States.
Yes. So I might have misspoke, yeah. Najot and Tessier and all those boys, yes, they are front and center here. And they arguably, I think I did I say Emmitsburg?
Yes,
Baltimore. And it's, you know, and there's back and forth over whether or not, was it Georgetown that was the first one or St. Mary's, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, Baltimore, all the way. But those guys reading, so what's cool, what's really fun is reading their lectures that they're giving to the young seminarians, the retreat notes that they're writing, that really trying to drive home what it means to be a priest. And, there's a textbook way, and then there's the side comments on, well, this kid was, you know, out too late, and this kid is pretty dumb, and this kid has a girl problem, and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And so they're right in the thick of it. And those guys are very good at writing down all their thoughts. Very, very good. Deluol is another one. Yeah, they're all there.
When I read Deluol's diary, every day it's dated by the temperature and the weather.
Exactly. Sir.
Just a couple things. You talk about the ignorant brothers. I think that actually is it refers to Christian brothers.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's not that the brothers were ignorant so much as they were set up to instruct the ignorant.
Yes.
Because that's what they call them, the ignorantelli, and the brothers. It makes it sound like poor brothers were out there in their ignorance. As a Vincentian, I was interested in the whole proposal here. Interestingly for me is that there were no Vincentians who fled France to come to the United States at the time of the Revolution. They went to the Papal States, they went to Spain, they went to England and other places. But none here, and I just don't know why.
Yeah.
That's just a fact.
Yeah, it's a strange fact, though.
Yes, it is.
And very few French priests came in the sort of the immediate tumult of the French Revolution.
Nor were there many French who ever came in our community to the United States.
Mm-hmm.
Just a handful, four or five maybe, even up to about 1900.
Right.
As a result, even though we were originally a French area than Louisiana. Mm-hmm. We didn't have we were the sons of Italy, I always say.
Yeah.
And so we had a much different perspective, and how that affected the development of the church against this other French background, I'm not sure, but it certainly has to be in there.
Yeah, I agree. And there's a, what is the book called? There's a good book on Italian missionaries in the American West. Brokers of Culture, I think is what it's called. So I would recommend that. And I can't recall the extent to which the Vincentians play a role in that book, but I think it probably does play a pretty good part. So that might answer some of those questions.
There weren't that many Italians either.
Right.
Because they came, it was a handful, and then they started receiving people like John Timon and others who were either American-born or Irish.
Yeah.
Quite early on.
So yeah. Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. Sir?
Mother Seton's Sisters of Charity were more successful with the Italians, weren't they?
I would think so. I don't know enough about them. You got an answer for that?
Do you mean with the recruiting Italian sisters, or
no,
what do you mean?
No,
in terms
I mean
of
serving
ministries?
The Italian community.
Okay. Well, the here. Italians were later
a later
immigration group, and at that time, the Sisters of Charity of New York and of Cincinnati had been established and happened to be where the Italian immigration was happening. Probably also the Daughters of Charity. But that would be up in the New York area.
There were two blood sisters.
That's Cincinnati
sisters,
the Blondina Sigali and her sister.
I was struck, you touched on this a little bit, about sort of retention rate of some of these gentlemen. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit more, not just about the missionaries, but of some of the bishops who, I'm thinking of De Burgh and Rosati both, who, you know, I sort of think of as quintessential frontier bishops along with Flaget, mm-hmm. but who seemingly as quickly as they could left the United States and went back to their respective countries, or in Rosati's case to Haiti.
Right.
And why that might have been the case, where they just burned out, or did they really not see a future for themselves in the American church?
I know De Burgh the best here in terms of bishops, mm-hmm. the higher profile cases like that. De Burgh just had a meltdown. He really and truly did, a slow and then quick meltdown. And he was really just a mess by the time he left. Mm-hmm. And the way that he describes, and he writes a letter to the Pope, several of them, trying to make his case for why he needs to leave. And he's just distraught. And he's the kitchen sink in there of reasons why. And he says a lot about his character, how he's not up for the job. He's not up for it. Rosati, I thought, was a little more professional. He stood up to the frontier quite a bit better. And I think it's a testament to the fact that he went to Haiti, which is not a difficult place to continue one's vocation.
He was sent there.
It was difficult to, it wasn't Europe.
But even Flaget is constantly trying to step down and for a while and is reappointed, and it's just a constant struggle for these guys to remain at task.
Oh, he was just super dramatic, that guy. But yes, and he went to France, as in most of the bishops, as often as they could, or Rome. Flaget actually shared a pinch of snuff with the Pope one time. That was a cute little anecdote in one of the letters. Pretty neat. Yes, ma'am.
I would like to know whether there was any involvement in the politics of France. Were they following very closely what was going on in France? And I'm talking about definitely the Revolution, mm-hmm. and the Concordat, Napoleon, and Napoleon's loss of Louisiana also.
Yes. So, yes, especially the Concordat, because it's earlier on in the 19th century. Yes, and the Sulpicians are very involved in those kinds of negotiations over what that's going to mean for priests. But it's at the higher level. Ollier is the the leader of the Sulpicians at the time, and he's Emery is. Ole is the founder. Emery is leading the Sulpicians at the time, and he's sort of the front of the house there in terms of those negotiations and how the Sulpicians are going to react to that. And most other Sulpicians and priests in general are going along with their superiors. So that's how I would describe their interaction. But they're definitely attuned to it because their fates, you know, rest in it. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Pasquier. You left us wanting to hear more, although I'm not an Americanist, so it says something. Anything to say or comment on regarding ties with Canada?
Yes.
The French Church in Canada, the Catholic, I mean in French-speaking Canada.
Yes. Yeah, so it's something that it has to do partly with my bias towards Southern history. So I ended up telling a story about the South. But that the French missionary story, there's another trajectory that angles further north and Midwest, particularly through Michigan and through Maine. And Michigan, is you're going to see Gabrielle Richard, who is going to become the bishop there, and as well as others, who are going to fall into a society that is also somewhat Catholic, but from that French Canadian background. So, that takes us into other places as well. But again, they're still falling into this new United States. So they're negotiating this French Canadian tradition with this westward American expansion, and how they align with the authority of the Premier See in Baltimore and their French connections to France as opposed to the French connections in Canada. And it's similar, although not as contentious, as what happens in Louisiana. Louisiana is a total mess.
It's nothing short of miraculous. Every single last one of them didn't flee.
Yeah, oh, totally.
Never mind who's going to stick around. It's like, why would they want to do that?
What are you doing here? Yeah. And I would add that where there are Native American missions, they're more commonly going to be in places like Michigan or out of that orbit, just because it is more of a Western frontier where Native peoples have not as dramatically or not as drastically been removed, although they're coming. One more, ma'am?
My observation is, from what you said, there was one dimension of the church that wasn't referred to, and that was the Paris instrumentality in building or creating congregations of women religious.
Yes.
And the Sulpicians certainly were primary in that, with the idea of establishing, opportunistically though, mm-hmm. a community based on the Daughters of Charity, but that it would be an American community.
Yes.
And so Flaget pushed that, and then Jean-Baptiste David tried to copy it in Kentucky, and
yep.
I'm sure there are others, but those are the ones that come to mind. So Du Bois, with his personality, really thought he was starting the Sisters of Charity with Mother Seton, but then in a huff he resigns.
Then
eventually he becomes the instrument to invite the Vincentians, which is very interesting in terms of birthing the charism here.
I think you're right. And one way in which one of the inspirations for writing this book about priests and the way that I tried to write it was based on the outstanding scholarship on women religious. We've done actually great work on the lives of women religious. And this is because of, you know, 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, and this reorientation of the historiography, right? We're going to look at everybody else, not just the dudes. And what I've found is that I tried to model my way of thinking about the priests in the way that historians have looked at women religious. And we kind of skipped, we haven't come back around to the priests, who I described earlier as oftentimes set up as foils mm-hmm. to everybody else who's Catholic. And I hope that comes across a little bit. And I do regret not having a chapter on their relationships with women religious, because it was strong. One example in Kentucky is the Sisters of Loretto, which was, they were recruited them or got them to come there, and it became a very important institution in Kentucky, similar in importance to like the Ursulines in New Orleans.
And Emmonsburg.
And Emmonsburg, exactly. I don't want to ever forget that.
That could be your next
Exactly.
So Dr. Pasquier, thank you very much.
Thank you.